Excuse me, I think we're going to get started. My name is Nancy Heggie Martin, and I am the Outreach Coordinator for the 21st Century Fund. I'm also the Director of the Science and Technology Center here at the high school. Tonight, to kick off the spring 2015 speaker series, the 21st Century Fund, we have Lillian Schopp, who is a senior at Housatonic Valley Regional High School. She spent her junior year in Jordan, and most of the fall, I believe. So anyway, she's going to tell us about her travels and her experiences while she was out of the country. So enjoy. We have one very important thing. I will probably be in a chair over here, so I'm easily found. We have two keys. We are unfortunately still have a frozen pipe. So we don't have any buildings. The buildings, if you go straight across the door, the buildings are just down the hall a little bit. If anybody doesn't know the high school, I can take you there, but it's sort of one of our problems. And if you haven't signed in, please do so on your way out. And if you can, give us your email, because that makes it just the easiest for us to get in touch with you to tell us about more things we're doing. Tell you about more things we're doing. Okay, thank you. Enjoy.
Okay, so I thought I'd start off by showing a clip because, you know, if you can't trust a celebrity to tell you about the world, you can't be trusted.
So. Can we do the lights a little bit more?
Is the volume?
Meet people on the street, they'd be like, how long are you here? I'm going to be here 5 weeks. You'll come to my house. I'm working. I'll be there yet. I'm coming in to pick you up. I'm not gonna, if you marry one of my daughters. You'll be in my family. You live in my house. You'll be me. You'll wear my clothes.
You will be me for 2 weeks.
You will be me for the rest of your life. You live here and you can't enter. I will live outside. I will live outside and I will be naked and I will cry at night, but it is okay because I just met you.
Is that hospitable?
So I just wanted to open with that because I thought that Jon Stewart was really spot on in his portrayal of Arab hospitality. There's really nothing like it. I went to my friend's house one weekend and I brought like a bag because I was spending 2 nights there. And her mom kept trying to like give me these pair of Tory Burch shoes. And these are like nice shoes. And I kept saying, please don't give them to me. I don't want them. I mean, it was borderline ridiculous. And so I went out for the day with my friend and we came back and her mom was driving me back to school and she hands me my backpack. And I get back to my dorm, I open my backpack. It is filled with food that she has cooked for me and the shoes on top of like the Tupperware food. Then the next day, my friend brings in a second bag to school full of my clothes that I wore in the weekend that my friend's mom had washed for me. So I just, that was one of the examples of just extreme hospitality. So anyway, I guess I'll talk about more about Jordan now. Okay, let's see if this works. Okay. So that under Jordan, that's Orden, which is how you pronounce it in Arabic. And so this is the map of Jordan. It shares borders with Egypt, Iraq, Syria, Saudi, Palestine, and Israel. And it's about the size of Indiana. It has a population of about 6 million, although it's really hard to keep track of the population in Jordan considering how it's pretty much always growing and fluctuating because of the constant influx of refugees. And this is a Jordanian flag. So it, as you can see, the colors are black, white, green, and red, and that's what most Arab nations share, the same colors of their flag. I tried to like find a collage of all the flags that there were none that were HD. So this is what it's like, and the Palestinian flag is the same, but without the white star, and the Emirati flag has the same set of, except instead of a red triangle, it's more a red rectangle. So. And green is really prevalent on Middle Eastern flags because it's the color of Islam. So I thought I'd just talk a little bit about Islam in case someone in here doesn't really know that much. So Islam is one of the three main religions in the world, and the people who practice Islam are called Muslims. And there are two main sects of Islam. There's Sunni, and I'm blanking on the other one because I'm really nervous. And there are five pillars. So there's the testimony of faith, which means that the only God you worship is Allah, which is God, and that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of his words. And then the next pillar is prayer. So Muslims, if you are strict and follow Islam like that, they're supposed to pray 5 times a day, starting at sunrise and ending at sunset. And then you're supposed to give zakat, which is help to the needy and the poor. So Islam's a really peaceful religion, and it's all about helping those around you. And that brings us to the next one, fasting during Ramadan, which is a holy month in Islam. And this year, and for the past couple of years, it's been towards the end of summer, but it rotates. And that's pretty much where you're supposed to fast from sunrise to sunset. Of course, there are exceptions. If you're sick or pregnant, you can drink water and eat. But it's supposed to give Muslims insight into how those less fortunate than them live. And it's also like really fun because it's a really peaceful time. So you can go out at like 2 a.m. and everyone will be out with their families, eating a lot of food and just celebrating. And the last one is to go on Hajj, which is where you make the holy like travel to Mecca in Saudi Arabia. And there are actually so many Muslims in the world that if you're an American Muslim, you're pretty lucky because you can go on Hajj whenever you want, as long as you get all the paperwork done and donate the money, because when you go, you have to, it's an expensive journey, and you also have to pay for someone else's journey who's less fortunate if you are able. But whereas people who live in the Middle East, you have to wait until you're 40 years old in some countries or 50 years old in others, because there are so many people there that people actually die every year in Hajj because it's just really hot in Saudi and so many people, you get trampled, I guess. But, and so I thought I'd show some pictures of what Muslims look like. I think everyone knows this man. This is Osama bin Laden. He's clearly not a favorite among Americans, but when I first moved into King's Academy in Jordan, my proctor, Najwa, came to my room and said, "Oh, you're American." And I said, "Yeah, I am." And then she goes, "Oh, me too, kind of. I was born in Boston. I lived there till I was 8, and I moved to Saudi actually because I didn't feel safe there as a Muslim." And I said, "Oh, really, why?" And she goes, "Well, because of my Uncle Osama." Oh. So my proctor was actually Osama bin Laden's niece. Mm-hmm. And I think that in America, he's really villainized. Obviously, what he did was awful, and he is a villain. But to them, he's just kind of like crazy Uncle Osama. So it was really interesting to get that perspective. And then there are Muslims like Muhammad Ali and Malcolm X, who I think are more notable for doing good. And then I think what many Westerners have in their idea of a Muslim woman is someone who's oppressed and has to cover their body, maybe not to this extreme, but even as far as wearing the hijab and covering your hair. And if you do go to a mall in Jordan, you can see women walking around and you can't even see their faces. And I was always so confused as to how they ate in public, but they actually lift and put it in, so it's a process. But it's really interesting because you see women walking around in traditional dress, and then you see Muslims like these two women. She's a famous actress. I've never seen a movie she's been in, but I don't know, she's an old white lady. And that's Amal Clooney, George Clooney's wife. So I just thought I would illustrate how diverse Islam can be, because I don't think that it gets recognition for that. I think it can be kind of stereotyped, especially in the Western world. But anyway, back to Jordan. So Jordan has a population of 6 million people, like I said before, and 97.2% of that population considers itself Muslim. And that ranges from really strict, conservative Muslims to really liberal. So the leader of the nation is King Abdullah of the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan. So I thought I'd show him in a couple different contexts. That's him in his military uniform. The bottom right is him at a UN assembly. Jordan is temporarily, non-permanently a part of the UN. And the top right is a photo of him at his daughter's graduation this past May. So his wife's like a 10 and he's like a 6, but that's okay. So a lot of people identify famous landmarks with Jordan if they know anything of it. And I think the biggest one is Petra. So I actually took these pictures when my mom came to visit. That's the Al Hizna, which is the treasury. And it was perfect because it's actually really hard to get a picture of this exact scene with camels in front because it's like so stereotypical, but I was so psyched about that. There you can hike up a mountain, and that's kind of the view from pretty much if you're standing on top of the treasury. And on the top right, that's just like a random Jordanian guy who heckles you to pay him for camel rides.
What was that building that we're looking at on the left?
That's the treasury, so it's called El Hesnan. Uh-huh. And you can't go in it or anything, you just kind of look at it. It's in the Indiana Jones movie, actually.
Is it built right into the hillside?
Yeah, it's carved right in, and it's actually it's really old, but it's a recent find. So it's one of the world's like wonders or something, and you go there and you pay like $70 to go if you're a foreigner. But if you're a Jordanian resident or citizen, you can pay like 50 cents. But
how did you get there? By car?
Yeah, by car.
Mm-hmm. It's a whole township that was carved in the desert, in the rock.
Yeah.
And they don't really know exactly how it was done, but it was a group that were desert travelers, and they somehow stopped there and began working for years and years to carve many, 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 many buildings to make their community. And actually, it's extremely interesting because the architecture of the different buildings incorporates at least 5 different architectural styles from history. And this took place very shortly after Christ, as I recall the timing. In February, there were 2 PBS specials concerning Petra, which were really brilliant shows on during the week. And they examined the different buildings, and a few of them, they deduced at the end, were actually burial sites. So they took you inside a few of these buildings. I don't remember if the treasury was one of them, and they showed you beds carved into the rocks. So they found out that a lot of the buildings in Petra were actually burial sites, because they were never able to figure out why different buildings were constructed there. But it's a quite large, and it's in the middle of nowhere, correct? You were there.
Yeah, that's what I was getting at. Like, the roads aren't even paved, so you go and you spend all this money and you think you're going to like this park that's just going to be great, that you can like walk a mile without any drinks, and it's like you're just pretty much walking on sand. So my mom came in like flip-flops, and luckily I had 2 pairs of sneakers. I don't know what she was thinking, but yeah.
Can I ask you a question? When you commented it's a recent find, was this somehow buried?
Yeah, like if people didn't really know about this, at least I learned this last year in my history class that I took there, that this wasn't really famous until last century.
It wasn't buried, it was discovered.
It was discovered. Okay.
So.
Did you say that the guy in the camel was on top of the building?
No, the bottom view. So if you actually hike up, it's really mountainous. You're kind of in a seek. So you walk in, there are these like huge, stone. Like you're in a seek. So there's a bunch of carvings on the wall of like caravans and stuff. And then it's really shady and you can't see anything. And it's so beautiful. You walk and like through the crack, you can see the treasury. And then you walk and it's just pretty much all open from there. And this is definitely the most scenic of the carvings, and there are a bunch of little like indents. Like if you see kind of by the camel's head, there's like that threshold. If you go in there, those are, you can see some beds there. And if you hike to the top, there's actually a sacrifice site, a sacrificial site. So it's pretty much just like a big rectangle. So it's amazing if you know what it is, but if it's not, it just looks like a pool that's empty. That's Petra, I guess. and then a lot of people know Jordan, the Jordan River or the Dead Sea. And I was actually lucky enough to go there. It's one of the most beautiful places I've ever been. From the Jordanian side of the Dead Sea, you look across and see the West Bank and Israel. And in Jordan, it's starting to become more like built up, I guess. Now hotels are kind of cleaning it and stuff, and so it's not like a beach, it's kind of like a resort where you have to go pay to see it, but the Dead Sea Scrolls were found on the Israeli side, I believe, but they do have a museum in Jordan that has a lot of the Dead Sea Scrolls, so if you're ever in Amman, I would recommend going to see them because they're pretty incredible.
Did you go swimming in the Dead Sea?
I did. It's really salty, and it's so salty that the rocks are covered in salt, and I went and I stepped, and I cut my foot open, and I had to go see the doctor and stuff, but it's really buoyant, and you can't swim on your stomach because you can drown because it's like that buoyant. You can't even turn over.
Oh, you have to stay on your back?
Yeah, you have to stay on your back. Yeah.
Wow.
So, the saltiest thing ever. Sodium. So that's Dead Sea.
Was it hot when you were there?
Yeah. So it's the lowest point in the world. So when you're driving down, the place where I went to school was about 40 minutes from the Dead Sea, and it snows there during the winter. Not a lot, but a little. And you drive about 40 minutes, and then it's 80 degrees. It's like a ridiculous change in temperature for such a short drive. I wish it was like that in New England.
So you're going down from your school to go to the
Yeah, it's like I think of my school as a pretty low point in elevation, and the guy who was driving us spoke no English, and I'm trying to speak to him in Arabic. I haven't been learning for that long, maybe a couple months. He takes the keys out of the car, puts them in his pocket. We're on a flat road, and all of a sudden we start moving forward because of gravity. Mm-hmm. The car was like, and it's the lowest point in the earth. The car can actually move without being. It was crazy.
He was saving gas. Exactly.
Yeah, saving gas. I'm trying to show us something very cool.
Gas is very expensive over there. As ironic as that is.
Yeah, for about a liter of gas, it's $15.
Wow.
So, and then if you cross the border to Saudi Arabia, a bottle of water is more expensive than a gallon of gas. So, mm-hmm.
You didn't tell us what took you to Jordan from Housatonic.
This is my first year at Uzi. So before that, I was at a private school in Rhode Island. And I saw a poster for it outside of an office, and I was always fascinated by the Middle East. Mm-hmm. So I inquired, and I asked my dad if I could apply, and he was like driving at the time working. And he was like, yeah, sure, whatever, okay. and then I applied and got in. And the King of Jordan actually went to Deerfield, and it's the King of Jordan school, he started it. Deerfield Academy, yeah.
He
in
started?
Massachusetts. No, he started King's Academy, sorry, in Jordan.
He went to Deerfield.
Based on Deerfield.
Yeah, so it's modeled, I would say, pretty loosely after Deerfield, but they would beg to differ. I forgot what the question was. What got me there. So I was pretty much ready for a change in environment, I thought, because I'm like always seeking adventure, and I convinced my parents to let me go, and, I guess I just kind of went. Pretty much. I went there in late August, and then I came back for Christmas, and then I went back until June, and then I returned this year in August again and left at the end of October. Because my parents were like, ISIS is coming to Jordan, like, definitely. And I was like, no, they're not. This is in September. And then it's a gated school, so we can't leave during the week if you're a boarder. And there are a lot of international students, so full boarding means that you stay there 7 days a week, like all the time, unless you sign out. And it actually got to the point where full boarders weren't allowed to leave campus because ISIS was telling them that they were going to target Caucasian people in the malls. And there's Jordan's still like a developing country, there's not a lot to do, so most of our trips on the weekends would be to malls, and we have a lot of Caucasian people who like are going to the malls on the weekends, so we weren't allowed to leave campus, and my parents were pretty much like, don't rot there for the rest of the year, you should come home. So I did, and then a couple, not too long ago, a Jordanian air pilot was actually burnt alive by ISIS, so just goes to show you. But I felt completely safe while I was there, and a lot of precautions were taken by people of authority to make sure I was safe, so I'm very fortunate. Jordan's pretty much just like an Indiana-sized desert wasteland type of place, so it makes for a lot of great hiking trips. For instance, this is a picture, it's really blurry because I got it off of Instagram, but this is a picture I took with my phone on our first hike through Jordan, and this structure right here is actually the remains of a Bedouin camp, and Bedouins are people who are native to the region, and they travel around, and they're pretty much shepherds. So when you hike, you can see them, and our first hike, one of my friends was wearing shorts that went to her knees, and these little kids started following her and throwing rocks at her and telling her dad was going to kill her if she wore her shorts again. So that was interesting. But and then it's really weird though, because you think, okay, these people live in the desert, they have no connection to technology, and then we'll be, sitting with them, having their tea, which is amazing, and they'll be like, oh, let me add you on Facebook, and I'm like, what? And they look at their, Samsung phone, and they're like, oh, yeah, we've got service out here. I have no idea.
What do you even have in Jerry?
Seriously, I don't even have it at my house, and I have it in the middle of the Jordanian desert. So that's the more rural part of Jordan, and then there are places like this. So this is taken on a really popular street called Rainbow Street, which it's actually called Rainbow Street, there's no Arabic name for it, in Jordan, and this is kind of what Amman looks like, the nicer part of Amman, I would say. And that's the Jordanian flag. A lot of people think it's a Palestinian flag because in Aqaba, which is in the southern region of Jordan, and it's kind of the only coastal town, it's on the Red Sea, they hung this huge Palestinian flag to show in solidarity, and Israel raised an even bigger Israeli flag, and so then Jordan raised a bigger one, so there's this huge competition going on, who has a bigger flag?
Good competition.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
It's
very interesting. Leave it at that, right? Who's got the bigger flag?
And then I was really lucky to get to stay in a green oasis like this. This is a view of King's Academy, which, like I said before, was started by King Abdullah in 2007. So it's a relatively new school, and which is awesome. So all the facilities are top-notch. This building is actually my dorm, and this is the freshman boys' dorm. So everything was kind of tiered based on what the king thought was most important. So on the top tier of campus, there was the academic building. And then on the second tier, there was some more like student life buildings and the dining hall. And then third tier was residential. And then if you go down the hill, we have our athletic fields. He says he doesn't think athletics are the least important to him, but that it just fit better there. But everything else is supposed to show how passionate he is about education. And he actually comes to speak to the school about twice a year, which is like one of the best experiences I've ever had. And he comes to educate us on what's happening within the Jordanian government. So the last time I heard him speak was January of 2014. And that's not the last time. The first time I heard him speak was January of 2014. And he was really hopeful that the Palestine-Israel conflict would be solved first, and that the Arab nations were reaching peace. And then the next time he came to speak, he was telling us how he was completely blindsided by what had happened in Gaza and Syria. So I think that in America, it's really easy to be blindsided by ISIS and be like, oh my gosh, what is this? But I mean, the second it's your neighbor, I think it's even more terrifying. But as a leader, I think that he's really admirable. And his response to the Jordanian air pilot getting, you know, held captive and killed was, I think, amazing, because he doesn't want to negotiate with terrorists, but he'll do so to protect his own people. And Jordan is such a small country where pretty much every person feels like they have a personal connection with the king, because he's able to travel around Jordan, and his wife as well, who's a huge advocate for women's rights in Jordan. And he actually went in traditional dress to a barbecue held by the air pilot's family, and went and hugged the whole family, which is, I mean, like, it's an even bigger deal than Barack Obama doing that, I think, just because America is so diverse, so I think people are always looking for differences, whereas Jordan is really amazing because it's one of the few Arab nations where I think people feel really united based on what nation they're from, and not other factors that make them different, whether it be religion or race or something, because Jordan isn't 100% Arab, it's actually 98% Arab, 1% Circassian, and I wrote down the other 1% Armenian, according to CIA World Factbook. But I think when you go to Amman, you can see definitely a lot more diversity there. And Jordan holds a special place in a lot of, I think, Middle Eastern people's hearts, because the dean of students at King's always said that we live in a bubble, in a place of turmoil, which I think is really true, because pretty much every nation that Jordan shares a border with has some sort of dispute going on, but Jordan has been able to remain stable, even though its economy is awful, because it has no natural resources besides shale oil, which no one is looking to buy. And it continues to have an influx of refugees due to its safety, and it just can't, the land itself can't support that many people. So I think that I don't know, Jordan's my favorite Arab nation, I guess. But yeah. And then, so just to show you what the town King's Academy is like, this is a picture I took before I left my shoulder. So this is like one of the few signs in English that's actually spelled the right way. They don't have a, there's no P in Arabic, so usually they'll spell it with a B and it'll be pizza, but I thought that was really interesting because there's a Mystic Pizza in Connecticut, so I just thought it was hilarious. And then you have like this family walking in front. And then next door there's a bunch of like rugs for sale, so I just thought that was really funny. But yeah, that's pretty much all I have to say.
What did you wear?
Oh, yeah.
Like in that street scene, what would you have been wearing?
Pretty much anything that covers, well, I never went out in shorts. Within Amman, or this city that Kings was in, was called Madaba. So I would never show my legs there, because that's really uncomfortable. And when we first got there, they actually had a meeting for all the girls who were foreign, saying, do not show your legs, because if something happens to you and you take it to trial, it's going to be your fault, because they're going to say you showed your skin. So although I think Islamic women are very empowered and moving towards a brighter future, they're still somewhat oppressed based on societal norms. So pretty much what I would wear would be jeans, and pretty much what I'm wearing now, actually, jeans and a long sleeve t-shirt, maybe something that covered a bit more of my chest region.
Did you have to cover your hair or no?
Only if I was going in a mosque, but I never felt like I, some people do cover their hair, but I never felt like I had to. Jordan's more progressive in that sense,
yeah.
And I actually, I don't. Voltaire once said, like, even if I don't agree with your opinion, I'll still fight for your right to have it. And I think I met even a lot of Arab women at my school where they don't really believe in the hijab, and I don't know if I do personally, but I would definitely fight for someone's right to wear it no matter what. But I think that covering your hair should be out of respect for either your religion, yourself, or like a personal choice about you and not what everyone else is doing. So I think if I were to cover my hair, it would be more about other people and not about me, and I wouldn't feel comfortable doing that just because I don't like being told what to do, I guess. yeah, so.
What are the kind of rules that you have to obey?
Pretty much if you were in public and you couldn't really walk with guys, like if I was actually with two boys and I was walking, and that was just not a good idea actually to be walking without a couple of the girls, because not that I was threatened or anything, but people would make comments as I walked by, especially because I'm white. So, and it's very common there for Russian women to be prostitutes and stuff, so if they see anyone with fair skin, it's they can get confused, I guess. And at the school, there are a list of expectations, and everyone likes to joke about expectation number 6, which it states, I quote, students must refrain from sexual intimacy, and that means, like, you can't really hug a boy if you're a girl, or you can't hug a girl if you're a boy, so pretty much refraining from unnecessary physical contact with the opposite sex. And let me think of other, oh, this is a perfect example. So my mom came to visit me in February, and my friend's driver was driving me to the airport to pick up my mom. And my mom is this very outgoing woman, so she, you know, gets off, I see her, I say hello, and I introduce her to the driver, and she sticks out her hand and says, hi, I'm Shannon. And I just wanted to facepalm right then and there, because that's just not normal for a man to shake a woman's hand, especially in the area that King's was in and that the airport is in. If you're in Amman and you're a businesswoman and you're meeting a businessman, you can shake his hand, but it's not typical at all for men and women to shake hands or have any physical contact, especially in public. Which makes dating in the area interesting, because my teacher, one of my favorite teachers at King's, was actually a white guy from Wisconsin, and he was married to an Iraqi woman, and he told us this like 3-hour long story about how he finally convinced his wife to marry him. I'll tell you the details, but pretty much it's a lot of being very coy and talking on the phone. So he says Arab women do this eye thing, like they'll bat their eyes at you, and that's when you know. And then you're supposed to text them. And if you go on a date, you'll say, okay, let's meet at Mystic Pizza for coffee at 7. But they won't sit at the same table, and they won't even talk to each other, and they'll try not to look at each other. You actually sit there on your phone and text them. But that's considered a date because you're in the same spot. So
sounds like over here, though.
Is this actually, this picture, is this, do you feel that that's a family? Is that kind of what happens? Men walk in front of the women? Is that? Is that?
No, that guy's not part of the family. He works at the store over. That one's just walking with her kids.
Okay.
Yeah. But I think it depends which region you're in. There are, you know, a lot of Arab women who, like, you know, the man's the head, the woman's the neck, and they're very, you know, persuasive and stuff. But I think that a lot of treatment of Arab women is out of respect. So the whole not shaking the hand thing is supposed to be like, I'm not good enough to shake your hand. But I think some people get it construed as, you're not good enough to shake my hand.
So when you went into, did you go into a lot of homes?
Yeah, I did.
So would the man not be in the same space, or would they share spaces? Like, would it carry on into inside the home?
If I went to, like, my friend's house in Amman, when I first met her dad was like, he had just finished praying, and he was like, oh, like, come give me a hug, like, you're my daughter now, and, like, all this stuff, and he was great. And
so there was a lot of warmth.
A lot of warmth, and Jordanians as a whole, I think, want the visitors to feel super welcome. I mean, if you go there, the first thing they'll say is, welcome to beautiful Jordan. Like, that's the only thing you'll hear for like 15 minutes right after you get off the plane. But then when I went on Habitat for Humanity builds, it was a lot different. We didn't even see women until we went in the house. And the men that we were, or the boys that we were with on the trip building, weren't allowed to see the women. So the girls would go into a back room with women who just cooked us this beautiful meal that we all ate together. And we would sit there and ask them questions, and I met a 17-year-old girl who was married to a 43-year-old man.
Oh.
And she had never, she was like, oh, like, tell me what the teenage boys look like. And it was like, it broke my heart. But at the same time, I just have to think, the only reason why I feel sad about that is because it's different from me. And I don't know how she felt about being married to an older person. She didn't really share her emotions about that. I think that's just their normal in rural Jordan. So I think after that, my American friends and I were like pretty rattled about the whole situation. But at the same time, I don't know if, you know, democracy and like all of this, like all of, I don't know, everything that we're fighting for in America, which I think would work great in America, I don't know if that's a universal truth. I think you can't go into another ancient place and tell people to change how they live. So I really battled with how I feel about how women are treated in Jordan, because I don't really think it's my place to judge that, I guess, is what I concluded after being there for a while.
Could you talk about the education you received? What did you study? Is it different?
The education I received is top-notch, I would say. It's modeled after Deerfield, so most of the classes I took were taught in English. And I took, you know, AP Physics, AP Psychology. I took two intensive Arabic classes. I took an honors English class. I took pretty much any class they can take at Hoosie besides, you know, like the ag programs and like woodshop and stuff like that. So any regular American curriculum can be taken at King's. And then there are interesting classes like Islamic theology, which every Jordanian student has to take. So they have their own special requirements to get Tawjihi, which is, I think, a pretty corrupt system to qualify Jordanian students for college, because the college process in Jordan is completely different from the college process in America. The education I received was great. I would say for non-international Jordanian, other Jordanian schools in Jordan, it's really corrupt and not fantastic. So.
And what's next for you? College?
I'm going to George Washington University in Washington, D.C., and I'll be in their international affairs school, but I have no idea what I'm, you know, focusing specifically on. But
set up the next trip.
Yeah.
How many, oh, I'm sorry.
And you may have said this and apologize if I didn't click, but how many of the kids at King's College were Jordanian and how many were international?
So specifically Jordanian, like their parents are Jordanian, I'd say about 50%, but then about, I'd say 45% more were kids who lived in Jordan, but their parents were either Palestinian, Kuwaiti, Emirati, you know, Iranian. Like this one girl that was my neighbor, her passport was Canadian. Her mother was half Korean, half Chinese, and her dad was Iranian but lived in Dubai. So you meet a lot of people, like, you cannot go there and be like, oh, where are you from? Because then it's like, oh, well, my mom's from Haifa, and my dad's from Kuwait, but, you know, they both grew up in Oman, and then they moved to America and had me, and then I moved back to Yemen, and now I live in Haiti. It's like, whoa. It's like you get the whole life story when you ask where people are from, and people get really sensitive about where they're from because the borders in the Middle East have changed so much over the past century. So,
well, you mentioned that Jordan's in the middle of this rather turbulent neighborhood. Yeah, it seems to be an island of calm and stability and order. People get along well. What do you think explains that, and how does the country function? Because they don't have any natural resources, and yet seems to, I mean, are most people living from farming somehow, or what is the lifestyle?
That's an interesting question, because King Abdullah actually addressed that specifically, because he was talking about how he has hope for Jordan's future, but he doesn't know if, you know, they can continue to live like this. And he's had a lot of people, because it's a constitutional monarchy, which means they have a parliament and they have a monarch. Mm-hmm. But the whole political system in Jordan is really messed up. So pretty much King Abdullah makes the major decisions, which I think is good for Jordan right now. And he said that he's had parliament try to tell him, you can't accept any more refugees because we can't host this, we don't have a major export. And it's going to break the peace because we have, you know, with these refugees, who knows, you know, who they're affiliated with. Mm-hmm. But he wants to continue to bring in refugees. And he's had to make deals with several organizations, like being a part of the UN, they receive aid from the UN. A lot of people from the Peace Corps come in, although he didn't really explain what the Peace Corps does. I think it's just volunteers in Jordan, as far as I know. And recently, they're, like, hookah's really common in Jordan. People, like, smoke hookah for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Like, even eight-year-olds, you can just, like, see them smoking. So they just recently passed a strict law that you have to be 18 or older to smoke hookah, and a health organization is giving them money for that. And their biggest source of income now, I guess, would be from their nuclear power plants, which they're building in the desert. And at the end of King Abdullah's speech, you can get up and ask him a question, and one girl is vehemently against the power plants, and he kind of shut her down saying, Jordan's not going to exist without these because it'll crumble economically without it. So the main resource, I guess, will come from the nuclear power plants, which will be done in 2017.
So they sell the power to the other countries then, or?
Yep, they sell the power to the other countries because a lot of people say, well, what about the Jordan River? Why don't they give water to, you know, but that's not theirs to claim, so they can't even sell water. So their only resource is nuclear power now.
Tell me a little bit more about the king. Do you know how long he's been king?
Yeah, he became king in 1999 after his father died. And he's, like, really cool. He was in Star Trek. He was an extra on Star Trek. I don't think he had a line. But, and his dad was, like, in love with automobiles. So we went to his father's automobile museum, and he has the Tron mobile. Like, I've never seen Tron, but it's like this huge motorcycle with, like, two big wheels, and he's, like, you always think of, like, political leaders, like, oh, like, they're all, you know, crooks, so you can't really connect with them, but there's something about King Abdullah that I just really respect, and I feel like you can connect with him on a personal level, and I think if you ever get a chance to read his book, The Last Best Chance, Mr. Stanfall, shout out to you, because he gave it to me. I haven't finished it yet, to be honest. But he talks about how he's really pro-democracy and what he plans for Jordan, and kind of his morals and ethics are explained in that book. And I just think he's great, and I think he really strives for peace. And I, furthermore, which I think is really important, think that he's really realistic about his goals, especially with Palestine and Israel. A lot of leaders of the Arab nations are saying that, you know, they don't want a two-state solution, they only want Palestine to exist, but he's pretty much saying, like, there has to be a two-state solution because both countries are legitimate and they both deserve to exist in this region, so I think he's...
He went to Deerfield. Was he also educated in college in the United States?
He was educated in college in the UK, I know, and then he went to a military academy in Jordan, but do you know him?
Sandhurst, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that. There you go. Well, and his son actually goes to
Georgia. He read the whole book.
Yeah, he read the whole book.
Well, Lily, you're talking about books. You read a book, I think it was What We Did Wrong or What Went Wrong.
Oh, I haven't finished that yet. That's something
that okay. Well, in reading, what do you think is your most influential either book or publication? Or
I think that...
Documentary, you know, something that you feel is important to that region that people might not be aware of or know about.
I think we have the UK to blame, to be honest. I mean, everyone likes to point fingers at the Americans because, you know, like, we're the loud travelers and we're in here and blah, 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 which I don't agree with, but pretty much Gertrude Bell went and drew a map of the Middle East, and she's this, you know, woman from Great Britain who's somewhat familiar with the Middle East, but after living in the Middle East for less than a year, I can't draw a map and say, oh, this is how it should be run. And I kind of feel like she did that, and that creates a lot of border disputes. So I think Great Britain and trying to expand.
Who was this person?
Gertrude Bell.
What was her, she drew a map?
She drew a map of Iraq and pretty much like the Levant region.
That was 1920 or 1920.
Yeah, so
the Balfour Declaration that started the whole thing rolling in 1917.
I think Gertrude Bell was before that, and then, to be honest, not really sure. But, yeah, so I think I blame Great Britain. I blame the British, to be honest.
Blame the Brits.
Yeah, they're like always, they were trying to expand and it didn't work, and I think that I was taught from like a really biased, the teacher from Wisconsin, he was really biased about this whole thing, but I would blame Great Britain for trying to expand their kingdom and then telling people the best way to live, so.
I have another question. How's your Arabic?
Not as good as I thought it was going to be honest, after living there for a year, but I'm pretty conversational and I can get around. And the thing about Arabic is, like, it's so different in every region. So, like, people from Palestine, Jordan, and Lebanon, they pretty much have similar accents and I can understand people from there, but, like, if you go to the Gulf, it's so different. If you go to Egypt, they pronounce letters in a completely different way. And then, like, Morocco, we went there for a spring break trip. I couldn't understand anyone, and no one could understand us, so.
And yet, theoretically, it's the same language?
And, yeah, that's because there's two different parts of Arabic. There's Fusha, which is the written part, which a lot of people are supposed to speak, and that's what the Quran is written in. And that's supposed to kind of be like the universal Arabic. And then there's the spoken. So in Jordan it's called Hamia, but in other nations it's called a different Arabic phrase, I guess.
Can you tell me in Arabic which nationality the king of Jordan's wife is from?
Philistine. She's from Palestine.
And not in Arabic.
Oh, okay. Let me think for a moment. Okay. Zawjati al-Malik Palestinian.
Lovely.
So that, yeah. So it's like the wife of the king is Palestinian. So yeah, and that's actually kind of, that was at first when they got married a huge conflict because they're like, why are you marrying a Jordanian? But people have really come around to her now because she's amazing and beautiful. She actually spoke at the graduation this year. Yeah.
Well, I probably not a fair question to ask you, but you've been to Istanbul and you've obviously seen that. Real secular cosmopolitan Turkish Islamic influence. Do you ever envision, I should probably ask you this, a graduation day from Georgia, do you ever envision a time where a more secular Middle Eastern, let's say Turkish Istanbul sort of situation could be more predominant in any ways? You did like Istanbul, right?
Yeah, I love Istanbul. That's a great city. I thought there was actually a lot of unrest in Istanbul, and it kind of seems even more divided than Jordan. So I don't know. My mom will always be like my, you know, number one, I guess. But definitely not in Saudi Arabia. As far as Jordan goes, I think that it's just been in the history for so long that there will always be Islamic influences over that government. But honestly, if I look at the American government, and even though we don't have like a national language or a religion or something, I think there's a lot of Christian, like a lot of politicians are talking about their Christian values. And there's a quote by Jimmy Carter, like, oh, if you don't want to help the poor or something, you don't want a Christian nation or something. And I felt like, being like, well, I don't want a Christian nation. That's why I live in America. I want, you know, a non-religious government. But I think that every nation has a government that's influenced by religion. And I think that Jordan is moving to a place where it's becoming less and less influenced by Islam, especially with a younger generation, because the majority of Jordanians are actually within the age group of, you know, 0 to 14 years old. It's like 35% or something. So it's a young nation. And I think that my generation's really enlightened, but I feel like everyone thinks that, so I'll let you know in a decade and a half.
Lillian, what, and maybe there's nothing to add as far as the Round Square Conference. Can you tell people about that?
So there's this organization called Round Square, and I really encourage you to Google it. It's great. I don't know who started it, to be honest, but it's pretty much this organization of schools from six continents who get together every year, and it's actually grown so much that they have two conferences a year. So this year, one was in India in October, and the second was held at King's Academy in October, and it was a huge deal because the next time that a Round Square conference will be in Jordan, I won't be alive. It's going to be in like 100 years because there are so many schools and they try to rotate throughout. So there are like 5 or 6 schools from the states that are in Round Square. Deerfield's one of them.
Hotchkiss's.
Oh yeah, Hotchkiss is a part of it, but they actually didn't come to the Round Square conference this year. I really want my cousin to come, but
When it happened, actually, when Lillian went to Istanbul, it was a time of tremendous unrest.
Oh, yeah, they almost didn't let us leave the country. Yeah. I forgot that.
It was at a moment when what you were seeing on television was at its highest peak as far as media frenzy. And there were a lot of concerns at that time. Schools were bailing out on it. In fact, Malala was the...
Oh, yeah, Malala used to... I've never learned how to pronounce her last name the right way. She was supposed to come speak at the Round Square conference, and she pulled out because she actually, I don't think she's been back to the Middle East, so this was supposed to be her big debut back. There was so much unrest that she decided.
And she won the Nobel.
Oh, she won the Nobel Peace Prize.
Right.
Yeah,
so she was actually...
Oh, yeah, at the same time, the king and queen of Jordan, they were in, like, what, Denmark or something? And Malala was there? I don't know.
Yeah, so I think it's in Copenhagen.
What a small world. I'm not sure where it is. I don't know. But, so we did this conference, and pretty much kids from all over the world came, and every day we would talk about, like, emotions and stuff. I don't know. And one day we talked about political stuff, and there was this one Jewish boy who was just very Jewish, and... You would be hard pressed to find a person in Jordan who is like really pro Judaism. It's kind of disgusting how much hate they have for Israel and Jewish people, and not really a lot of understanding. So this one kid didn't really get the lay of the land and was claiming his, you know, Jewish ideals and how he believes that Israel should be the only nation and that Palestine shouldn't exist. And these like 4 Palestinian kids from King's went to his dorm room and pretty much like intimidated him, and he started crying and it was just a mess. So boys at Uzi get in fights about like, I don't know, like the tractors and who gets to drive the ag bus and stuff. But like in Jordan it's like, you insulted my mother. Like the worst curse word in Arabic is like saying your mom's vagina. But like a more artistic word for vagina. And that's just like the word, like you can get kicked out for saying that word at King's. And this one kid said it to this other kid, I guess, at King's, and they got in this huge fist fight. So I don't know, it's just people fight about different things over there. So it's like kind of hilarious, but also heartbreaking to see these people fight about like Palestine and Israel and stuff. And I'm over here, like people worry about I don't know, just smaller things, I guess. But everyone has their hardships, so.
You made a comment once, though, that was interesting, that some of the teachers at King's were Jewish, and the kids knew it, and everything, people got along, that you didn't sense.
Oh, yeah, so.
The friction between a largely, you know, as we perceive it in the news, as two combatants.
Yeah, I think that people, like, Jordan, like, it is a very polar area sometimes, like, you're very one thing and very not another or something, as far as it goes, like, Palestine, Israel, so you're gonna, it's hard to find an Arab who's like, no, Palestine shouldn't exist. I've yet to meet one. But there are a lot of Jewish teachers at the school I went to, and I was fortunate enough to go to a school where most of the students were open-minded or trying to be open-minded. So there was no issue with, you know, the students being taught by Jewish teachers. I think the problem doesn't come with Judaism necessarily. It comes with extreme, like, love for Israel. I'd say that's where the friction really starts. So, but there's always like that uncertainty, like, you're like, are you Jewish? And someone's like, yeah, I'm Jewish. They like stare at you. It's like a deer caught in the headlights, you know, like no one's really quite sure what the next move is. So they're like, but I support Palestine. So
yeah.
You kind of have to. And I'd also just, you know, after coming to America, kind of was like, oh, I have to brace myself for all these ignorant questions and stuff. And I mean, I went to the Middle East. I didn't really know that much about the Middle East at all. But I think that Americans don't get enough credit for how educated and worldly we actually are. And, you know, when I went to Jordan, my first visit, like, oh, like, you thought that we all, you know, were terrorists and rode camels and lived in tents. And I'm like, thinking, I didn't even know there were camels in Jordan. I didn't know what the weather was like here. I don't, like, 3 years ago, if you asked me to locate Jordan on a map, I have no idea where it is. So I think it's, like, the mindset in both areas, like, oh, they hate us and they're terrorists, and then it's, oh, well, they think they're terrorists and they hate us. It's, like, more of a misunderstanding than, like, what's actually happening, so, I don't know.
Is the press free in Jordan?
Yeah.
Well, I hope you come back and after you graduate from George Washington and tell us, and then go into the State Department and all that business.
No, thank you.
That's great.
We have some refreshments if anybody would like, very light, but if anybody would like a nibble, anyone needs to use the rest.